Nancey, I'd love to prove the existence to God, and I come to you for help. Can you help me?
No, sorry.
I'm disappointed.
Well, first of all, to prove the existence of anything is something that logicians and mathematicians think is out of the question at this point. And so what your question really needs to be is it possible to give convincing evidence for the existence of God? And there have been short little arguments created throughout the modern period based on the order of the universe. We all know of William Paley's work, etc. Basically, none of those have succeeded. The way I understand it at this point is that we need to see arguments for the existence of God not as arguments for adding this one entity to a worldview that we all share, but rather as finding a way to argue legitimately for one entire worldview that incorporates a theistic point of view against another entirely complete, coherent worldview that's naturalistic. And some people would say that that's impossible. The relativists would say it can't be done. I am one of the probably a few anti-relativists that say that under some circumstances it can be done, but it takes a huge amount of work. It takes an understanding of the development of those two traditions over the course of their history, looking at the kinds of intellectual crises each of them has faced, seeing whether they can resolve those crises with the resources that the tradition has within it, etc. And so nobody with a book this thick can provide you adequate evidence to believe in God. It would take a short library.
So you really must go back into the traditions and do a historical analysis of the development of each argument in both traditions in order to compare them?
Absolutely. One of the things that philosophers of science recognized in the 1970s is that there is no such thing as instant rationality. If you want to compare two scientific theories, you can't just compare them on the basis of the evidence that this one and this one has right now. You have to look at how each of those theories has developed over time. And all the more so if you're talking about these large-scale worldviews or traditions. You've got to see how resilient they have been to criticisms and new challenges and developments over the course of, I would say, centuries.
Although you would really have to give extra weight to current thinking because the logic and the science has developed substantially since earlier times.
That's true. That's true. You certainly want to see what condition each one is in at present. And so you want to see, for instance, has the Christian tradition overcome some of its most challenging crises in the modern period? But also, what are the crises that the naturalist tradition faces? For instance, can it provide a satisfactory account of why we should be moral? I'm not sure that it can.
But in both cases, you are looking at a balance, not an absolute destruction of the other?
That's quite correct. I think there may be some cases where a tradition really does fall on such hard times in terms of its own intellectual integrity that if it's maintained, it's maintained in a sort of fundamentalistic way. But most likely it will be abandoned by its intelligent adherents and they will adopt a tradition that is more adequate, more lively, and more relevant to the contemporary intellectual scene.
The common understanding is that the Christian tradition thinks it can prove the existence of God through a whole series of scientific arguments or moral arguments or religious experience arguments. Do you see yourself as differing from the mainstream?
Well, every little piece that a Christian scholar does to argue against a criticism of the tradition or provide evidence for a significant part of the tradition, that's a part of the task of justifying the tradition. And so, for instance, I wouldn't see a seminary like this having a single person who is the teacher of apologetics, what I tell my students is every single scholar in this institution is involved in apologetics, because the historians are teaching you about the crises that the tradition has faced in the past and how they've been overcome. The biblical scholars are helping you to understand and apply the authoritative texts that were written 2,000 years ago and showing their meaningfulness for the present. The ethicists and the people in the ministry department are showing you how these intellectual ideas can actually be put into practice in a living social body, a living community. So every single person engaged in theological education is contributing to the apologetic task. And so long as we have a lively, intellectually honest, ongoing process of recognizing our intellectual crises, dealing with them honestly, and furthering the development and content of the tradition, we're doing part of the task of justifying the existence of God. But of course, there is that other task, which is to look at the competitors and say, hey, folks, how are you doing over here with your crises?